Lord of all joy, whose trust ever childlike no cares can destroy, be there at our waking and give us, we pray, your bliss in our hearts, Lord, at the break of the day. Lord of all eagerness, Lord of all faith, whose strong hands will skilled at the plane and the lathe, be there at our labors and give us, we pray, your strength in our hearts, Lord, at the noon of the day. Lord of all kindliness, Lord of all grace, your hands swift to welcome, your arms to embrace, be there at our homing and give us, we pray, your love in our hearts, Lord, at the eve of the day. Lord of all gentleness, Lord of all calm, whose voice is contentment, whose presence is balm, be there at our sleeping and give us, we pray, your peace in our hearts, Lord, at the end of the day.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace and peace of God our Father, and the love of Jesus Christ our brother, the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you.
And with your spirit.
Sisters and brothers, we are nearing the end of the season of Lent as we are going to be preparing for Holy Week next week. Let's prepare our hearts then to celebrate this Eucharist and this time together. Lord Jesus, you raise the dead to life in the Spirit. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You bring pardon and peace to the sinner. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You bring light to those in darkness. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to life everlasting.
Amen.
Let us pray. Lord our God, by your help, we beseech you, may we walk eagerly in that same charity with which, out of love for the world, your Son handed himself over to death. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Jeremiah. The days are coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant I made with their fathers the day I took them by the hand and led them forth from the land of Egypt, for they broke my covenant, and I had to show myself their master, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will place my law within them and write it upon their hearts. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer will they have need to teach their friends and relatives how to know the Lord. All, from least to greatest, shall know me, says the Lord, for I will forgive their evil doing and remember their sin no more. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Create a clean heart, a clean heart in me, O God. Create a clean heart, a clean heart in me, O God. Have mercy on me, O God. In your goodness, in the greatness of your compassion, wipe out my offense. Thoroughly wash me from my guilt, and of my sin cleanse me. Create a clean heart, a clean heart in heart, create for me, O God, and a steadfast spirit renew within me. Cast me now from your presence, and from your Holy Spirit take not from me. Create a clean heart, a clean heart in me, O God. Give me back the joy of your salvation, and a willing spirit sustain in me. I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners shall return to you. Create a clean heart, a clean heart in me.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. In the days when Christ Jesus was in the flesh, he offered prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverence. Son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered. And when he was made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Follow me, says the Lord, and where I am, there also will my servant be. Praise and honor to you, O Lord Jesus Christ.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
This is a reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Glory to you, O Lord. Some Greeks who had come to worship at the Passover feast came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and asked him, "Sir, we would like to see Jesus." Philip went and told Andrew, then Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Amen, amen, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains just a grain of wheat. But if it dies, it produces much fruit. Whoever loves his life loses it, and whoever hates his life in this world will preserve it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there also will my servant be. The Father will honor whoever serves me. I am troubled now. What should I say? Father, save me from this hour. But it was for this purpose that I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name. Then a voice came from heaven. I have glorified it and will glorify it again. The crowd there heard it and said it was thunder, but others said, an angel has spoken to him. Jesus answered and said, this voice did not come for my sake, but for yours. Now is the time of judgment on this world. Now the ruler of this world will be driven out. And when I am lifted up from the earth, I will draw everyone to myself. He said this, indicating the kind of death he would die. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. When we are children, our parents can seem to be stern, ominous, even foreboding. But as we mature, hopefully our appreciation of them deepens, as well as an adult relationship with them. The same change of understanding can be applied to our relationship with God. Isn't that what St. Paul means when he tells the Corinthians, when I was a child, I used to speak like a child, think like a child, reason like a child. When I became a man, I did away with childish things. Both personally and communally, our understanding of God should deepen. All too often, we see God in the Hebrew Scriptures as a child sees a parent, stern, ominous, foreboding, even vindictive. And when we get to the Christian Scriptures, suddenly God improves and becomes loving, tender, merciful, and forgiving. But is it God who has changed, or have we? The answer is obvious. God is God. And as God always has been and always will be, God is unchanging. The change in our understanding of God, of who God is, profoundly affects how we relate to God. One area in which we can trace this change of understanding is through the various covenants described in the Scriptures. Beginning with God's covenant with Abraham and subsequent covenants with Moses and David, again and again, God offered life-sharing opportunities to the people of Israel. It is important to realize that a covenant is not the same as a contract. It's not, I will do this if you do that. No, rather a covenant is a relationship built on mutual commitment and care. Perhaps the model of marriage vows is the best metaphor that we have for a covenant bond. Understanding this degree of intimacy and care took some time for Israel to grasp. A major shift in the model of the covenant between God and Israel is outlined in the first reading today from the prophet Jeremiah. In the 33rd verse of the 31st chapter of his book, Jeremiah describes the new covenant God will make with his people. He says, quote, I will place my law within them and write it upon their hearts. Whereas the old covenant included laws inscribed on stone tablets and was entrusted to the whole community, the law of the new covenant will be written on the hearts of individual members. Where the former covenant required external conformity, the new one will call for interior commitment and transformation. The new covenantal relationship will be entered into freely, with each individual being directed from within. The opening verses of the letter to the Hebrews indicates the urgency which God felt in connecting with God's people, an urgency seen in God's consistent efforts to communicate with them. It says, in times past, God spoke in partial and various ways to our ancestors through the prophets. In these last days, he has spoken to us through the Son, who he made heir to all things, and through whom he created the universe. And so the promise of Jeremiah is realized in Jesus. The final covenant is established through the blood of the cross. In the gospel passage, which we have just heard, which comes just before John's long description of the Last Supper, Jesus makes clear what this new covenant will consist in. The narrative opens with Greeks seeking to meet Jesus. Now, some scripture scholars speculate that this is included as an indication that eventually the gospel will be preached to the entire world. But Jesus replies to Philip and Andrew's information about the Greeks with the announcement that his hour has come. The hour that Jesus refers to is its time of his glorification, but also the hour that he dreads. It is both a time of anguish and of his exaltation. And this is demonstrated by the image he uses of the seed that must be sown. If you keep a package of seeds in the glove compartment of your car or on the shelf in your garage, nothing will happen. Nothing will emerge. Nothing will be produced. The seed, to realize its potential, has to be planted and then stop being a seed in order for something more, something else to come forth, a flower, a vegetable, a fruit, a bush. And as this is true for a seed, so Jesus says it is true for human life. At each successive stage of life, hopefully we leave behind our former self for a deeper, fuller experience of life. The infant becomes a toddler, who becomes a schoolboy, who becomes a high schooler, who becomes a college student, who emerges as an adult. Jesus indicates that the same transformation must happen in our relationship with God. We must leave behind our former self in order to enter into this new covenant of life and love with God. Only through the willingness to relinquish one form of life can there be hope for another. We enter into this covenant when we share in the Lord's Supper and receive him in the Eucharist. But just as the Last Supper led to Calvary, we who share in this meal are called to imitate him in love and service, even to the point of carrying our crosses. The references to seed and its transformation apply not only to Jesus' situation, but also to that of his followers. And that brings us to the follower whose feast we celebrate this weekend, St. Patrick. Like we do with so many saints, we can easily romanticize and therefore deflate the substance of Patrick. He means a lot more than corned beef and green beer. Huh? He was a man of courage and conviction, even in the face of death. Our opening song for today's Mass was Lord of All Hopefulness, which was sung to the Irish tune called Slain, S-L-A-N-E. Interestingly, the hymn tune is always capitalized, not just the first letter, but the whole word. It refers to Slain Hill, which is about 10 miles from Tara in County Meath. It was on Slain Hill in 433 that St. Patrick defied a royal decree punishable by death by lighting Easter candles on Easter Eve. The High King Leary of Tara had decreed that no one could light a fire before Leary began the pagan spring festival, a druidic festival of the spring equinox, by lighting a fire on Tara Hill. The first fire, however, was not that of King Leary, but one lit by Patrick to celebrate the resurrection of Christ. Instead of executing him, King Leary was so impressed by Patrick's courage and devotion that he allowed him to continue his missionary work throughout all of Ireland, planting the seeds of faith that bloom to this day. We too are called to plant seeds even in the face of adversity. A favorite Italian saying of St. Pope John the 23rd encourages us in this. It says, Sotto la neve c'è il pane, under the snow there is bread. It refers to the winter wheat that is sown in the late autumn and comes to fruition the following spring. For all intents and purposes, it seems to those who fail to understand agricultural processes that this seed has been wasted. It lies in the cold ground. But deep within the earth, the seed has started to germinate, and with the warmth of spring will bring forth a harvest for food and life. So too in our lives, seeds from the Lord have been planted in our hearts by the care and the good deeds of others. Now, all too often, the struggles and trials of life, the winter storms of our existence, can encapsulate our hearts and make them frigid. But deep within, the potential for goodness and love lies buried. It is then that we must allow the Lord to once more write the words of his covenant upon our hearts. Words that will, as we sing in the Pentecost sequence, melt the frozen, warm the chill. It is then that we must accept his invitation to this covenant of eternal life and eternal love. It is then that we must plant seeds in the hearts of others, seeds of goodness, of peace, hope, healing, joy, of love. Seeds that, in the future, will yield yet another harvest for still others. Together, let us profess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there, he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. With confidence now, let us pray for our needs, the needs of the church, and the needs of the whole world.
For the church, that all the baptized may heed the call to lose oneself for the sake of the gospel and follow Christ by serving others. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For national leaders, that they conduct their work and with dignity and integrity, seeking what is best for the common good and attending to the special needs of the vulnerable. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For people who are burdened by feelings of guilt and unworthiness, that they will be restored by God's mercy and accept the profoundly forgiving love of God. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For all those suffering in body, mind, or spirit, and for continued healing for all those who have received prayer shawls from our parish. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For all those who have passed into new life this week, especially Nan Corcoran, and for all those dearly departed who dwell in the peace of the eternal Lord, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For our personal needs and the intentions written in the parish book of prayers, which we now offer in the silence of our heart, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Loving God, hear these prayers and the many prayers in each of our hearts. We are confident of your care for us. Send the Holy Spirit now to strengthen and to guide us. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Is not the cup we bless
the living bread of God, vine fruit of the land, wine a work of our hands, one cup that is shared by all. Falls on rock will wither and will die. The seed within good ground will flower and have life. Seed scattered and sown, wheat gathered and
pray, sisters and brothers, that this, our sacrifice, will be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice from our hands for the praise and glory of God's name, for our good and good of all God's holy church.
Almighty God, hear us, and having instilled in your servants the teachings of the Christian faith, graciously purify them by the working of this sacrifice through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For you will that our self-denial should give you thanks, humble our sinful pride, contribute to the feeding of the poor, and so help us imitate you in your kindness. And so we glorify you with countless angels, as with one voice of praise we acclaim. Lord, you are holy indeed, the font of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts by sending down your Spirit upon them so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, He took bread and giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat it. This is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the cup and once more giving thanks, gave the cup to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it. This is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and the everlasting covenant. It will be shed for you and for all, so that sins may be forgiven. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate this memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and this cup of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Lord, remember your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Michael, our Bishop, and all who minister in your church and all your holy people. Remember also our sisters and brothers who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your presence. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, and our Mother, and Joseph, her husband, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him, with him, in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen, 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 amen.
We join together now and pray with confidence for the coming of God's kingdom as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
And the peace of the Lord Jesus be with all of you.
And with your spirit.
Let's share with each other now a sign of the peace of Christ. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. May the body and blood of Christ keep us safe for eternal life. Amen.
Though not physically present at this Mass, as the baptized, we are always intimately united as the body of Christ.
I will plant my law, not on stone, but in your heart. Follow me, I will bring you back. You will be my own, and I will be your God. I will be your strength. For deep within, I will plant my law, not on stone, but in your heart. Follow me, I will bring you back. You will be my own, and I will be your God. Seek my face and see your God, for I will be your hope. I will plant my law, not on stone, but in your heart. Follow me, I will bring you back. You will be my own, and I will be your God. Return to me with all your heart, and I will bring you back. For deep within, I will plant my law, not on stone, but in your heart. Follow me, I will bring you back. You will be my own, and I will be your God.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we pray that we may always be counted among the members of Christ, in whose body and blood we have communion, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
This Mass is ended. Go in peace.
Thanks be to God.
And happy St. Patrick's Day.
us,
Lord, into the desert. Lead us through the wilderness. Through this journey we will follow, for we long to see your face. Gracious God, mercy is your name. Redeeming love, you give your life away. Gracious God, we bless your holy name. Receiving love, we give our lives away. Teach us, Lord, who is our neighbor? Is it friend or enemy? When we welcome or condemn them, it is you, oh, let us see. Gracious God, mercy is your name. God, we bless your holy name, receiving love.